everyone. This is Professor Jeff Wilkerson at Luther College, bringing you once again what to look for in the night sky, this time for the week of December 13th, 2021. And we'll go ahead this time and focus on the Geminid meteor shower that's this week, which a lot of times I've told you in the past, I don't like to talk about things everybody else is talking about because you can hear everybody else talking about them. And then I go on and talk about what everybody else is talking about. So there you go. But the Geminid meteor shower, we'll talk about it because it's one of my favorites. I'm sure that last year at this time, we said exactly the same thing. I love this meteor shower for a couple of reasons. One is very reliable. Year after year after year, you get a good count of meteors. I like it because, remember a meteor shower. We've talked about this in other videos. A meteor shower happens when the Earth's orbit intersects the debris left by a comet. So all of the meteors, that debris that's coming into the atmosphere and burning up that makes the meteors, they all look like they're coming from the same point in the sky. We call that the radiant. Now, they don't have to be anywhere near that radiant. They could be way across the sky, and you just trace it backward and say it would come from that radiant. So the radiant for the Geminid meteor showers is just above Castor here. Castor and Pollux are the two bright stars in Gemini. We're going to use this as an opportunity to talk about Gemini just a little bit. But so somewhere up in here is the radiant. And the meteors look like they're coming from that radiant, but they may be way across the sky. They may be way down here where we can't see them. But they're going to look like they're all coming from that point where we're intercepting. That wasn't a very good one, but where we're intercepting that debris cloud in the sky. It's a pretty consistent debris cloud. Some meteor showers are hit or miss depending on how much debris is where we happen to align up. This is one of the reasons I like this meteor shower is it's consistent year to year. Go outside if it's good and dark. It won't be terribly dark this year, at least not in the evening, because we've got a waxing moon a little past half full. So we got a gibbous moon that's waxing in the sky. So it's going to wash out the fainter meteors. But of all of the meteor showers, there's a lot of big, bright meteors in the Geminids. So that's one of the reasons I like it too. You got these big bright meteors, the moonlight's not going to affect it quite as much. You have a good chance of seeing meteors even with the moonlight right there. You just won't see as many. You might see almost one a minute if you had good dark conditions, if everything was ideal. My guess is you go out in the evening, Gemini will be rising into the sky at about 9 o'clock in the evening or something like that on Monday the 13th. So Monday the 13th is when this peaks. So don't delay watching this video. I don't know how you're gonna know that if you haven't watched this video, but this last week we had a beautiful pairing of the moon and Venus on the first night of the week, the Monday. And this time on Monday, we've got the Geminid meteor shower. So this is a warning for you to get out here and watch these things on the weekend before the week starts always. To get a sense of what you want to, how you want to plan your observing week. So the Geminid meteor shower, Gemini is going to rise into the sky. You know, by the time it gets to be 8 or 9 o'clock my time, local time here, vary a little bit depending on where you are. Gemini is going to be pretty high up in the sky. It's going to be up in the sky. Let's say that anyway. It's going to be up in the sky for me. By 10 o'clock, it's going to be pretty high up in the sky and easy to see. So that's another thing I like about the Geminids. So one thing I like is it's reliable year to year. The second thing I like is you've got big, bright meteors that can hold up to some moonlight. And sometimes they're slow. Given the angle, the way we hit this this cloud, sometimes we get pretty slow meteors that make them big and long-lasting and bright. They're just beautiful. They're some of the most consistent, beautiful meteors that you see. But also, with the radiant up at 7 or 8 o'clock at night, you don't have to stay up all night to see it. Sure, it's going to be better at 1 or 2 or 3 in the morning as the moon gets over here and sets, and the radiant Gemini gets up higher and higher in the sky. And I'm sure, you know, I'll be outside at 4 o'clock in the morning, and you bet I'll spend an extra few minutes outside at 4 o'clock in the morning if it's clear on Tuesday morning the 14th, looking for Geminid meteors. But that doesn't mean I'm not going to go out the night before and look for them too. So that's one of the things I like about it as well, is it's an all-night meteor shower. You can watch them in the evening, you can watch them in the morning. So get out, take a look at them, see if you can't see. My guess is, even with the moonlight, you go out in the evening, 9 o'clock at night, let's say, 10 o'clock at night maybe, you go out, and even with the moonlight washing things out a little bit, and hopefully it's not too cold, we're supposed to be pretty warm next week. If you're out there for 20 minutes, my guess is you're going to see, even with all of these other problems that might be washing things out, you're going to see 2 or 3 or 4, maybe 5 meteors, is my prediction. You know, it's going to vary. It's a random thing. So, but if you can get out there and hang out for 15 or 20 minutes, you'll probably see a couple of good meteors. And that's all, you know, a lot of times that's what I used to do. When I lived in California, sky didn't have good dark skies. And I would go out and walk in the evening of the Geminid meteor shower, the night of the Geminid meteor shower, just walk around the neighborhood and kind of look and keep my head up and see what was going on until I saw a couple or two or three or four of these things, and then I go back in and say, that's a good observing of the meteor shower. So that's what I recommend for you. Let's take a look at Gemini now, where this is, the radiant is located in Gemini. Again, Gemini's up pretty much all night now. We looked at Orion a couple of weeks ago and said, Orion's up all night. Gemini's higher in the sky than Orion. So Gemini and Orion are coming up together here. Castor and Pollux are the two bright stars, and I'm putting the magnitudes on there. We've talked about magnitudes a lot lately. Counts backwards, so a lower number is a brighter star. Every step is 2.5, a factor, a multiplicative factor of 2.5 in brightness. So you got three stars that are brighter than second magnitude. You got Castor and Pollux, the two main stars, the twin stars, in Gemini, 1.6 and 1.2, two of the 20 or so, 25 or so brightest stars in the sky. So the good bright star, but not much behind them is Alhaina down here at the end. So we think about if the Milky Way runs down this direction, and I think about the Gemini as the twins, the two bright stars up here and long strands of legs standing on the river of the Milky Way, or on the bank of the river of the Milky Way down here. In that case, Alhaina would be a foot star right there. And so Alhaina comes from the Arabic. I think we looked this up in Allen's. I looked this up in Allen's star names that I've shown you several times before. And my recollection is that typically means a brand mark. So it would be translated as a brand mark that might appear on a camel, for instance. Along the way is Al-Wasat, a 3.5 magnitude star. All of these stars, they're third magnitude stars. Makbuda here is fourth magnitude star, but these are all pretty visible stars that I've marked. So you should be able to see strings of stars stretching down from Castor and Pollux toward the river of the Milky Way above the head of Orion down in there. And so along the way is Wasat from Al-Wasat, again from Arabic, and it means the middle. Could be the middle of the constellation that we're looking at right here. And Al-Wasat is a good double star. So if you've got a telescope, particularly a decent-sized telescope, the two stars are relatively close together. But if you've got a 6 or 8 or 10-inch telescope, you should be able to resolve these pretty well and see this as a double star here. I think 5 or 6 arc seconds separates the two stars right here. So that's a good target for you. I'm going to recommend it as you're observing Gemini. If you walk the other strand up this way, Mepsuta and Mu are two stars that are about third magnitude stars. And it comes down here and it curves up. And you see the stars curving up this way just a few degrees above Mu, a nice third magnitude star that's above Alhaina down here, is M35, an open star cluster. So you probably can actually see that with a pair of binoculars. So you give that a try with a pair of binoculars. It's a really nice open star cluster. I think we got a picture of it on our website if you want to go look at it. And only about a half a degree from M35 is another open star cluster. Remember, open star clusters are these relatively loose groupings of stars where you can see the individual stars that you can't often in globular clusters. These live in the plane of our galaxy, the disk of our galaxy. That's what you're seeing right here. And so these constellations that are close to the disk of our galaxy are often rich in open star clusters. M35 is a beautiful one, and it's worth checking out in a small telescope. But so is one right next to it, half a degree away, NGC 2158. It's much further away, much denser, more stars. It's richer, a little bit harder to see. They're fainter stars, but there's a lot more of them, a lot more densely packed, and a lot richer. And if you have a wide field view, a wide field eyepiece, you can probably see both of these in the same field of view. So when you find M35, if you're looking through a telescope, poke around there with your telescope if you don't see NGC 2158 and see if you can pull that out. It may just look like, depending on what your telescope's like, it may just look like a fuzzy patch to you. And then you might be able to up the magnification a little bit and pull these stars apart into individual stars, or it might go away on you. So anyway, that's a good observing target, is to check out M35 and NGC 2158, two open star clusters right there. I think M35 you can probably see with a good pair of binoculars. Check out the other stars. Check out the double star if you've got a telescope for it, Wasat right there. And be sure to check out the Geminid meteor shower on Monday night the 13th. I hope you have good observing, everybody, this week. Enjoy Gemini, and we'll have something else for you next week.